So it's my honor to introduce Daoud Assad. Daoud is a survivor of the Deir Yassin massacre. For people who are unfamiliar with that massacre, it occurred on April 9th, 1948, and it was part of the terror campaign that Zionist militia, the Sturm Gang, the Irgun, Jewish Zionist militia used to terrorize Palestinians and send a message that if they did not voluntarily leave Palestine, that similar massacres would follow. And so Daoud is an author and has written a book that accounts not only his history, but the history of other survivors of Deir Yassin. He's going to share with us a very powerful story of his experience, both surviving that, but also being part of trying to resist it. Daoud has also brought those books here, and if you're interested, at the end, you can come up and buy a book and have him sign it. So please join me in welcoming Daoud.
Okay, I'm going to say now, because the 15 minutes that are allowed to ask, you know, how could you explain about the whole massacre which took place, how to explain about the Palestine problem, but I'd like to be short. But before I do that, you know, I want to greet you by the three greetings, say shalom, salam, peace be upon you all. And you are such a good, wonderful audience, and I want to thank the people who are working or who had worked on this project, you know, to bring it to reality and success, Sue and Sarah and others in here. I don't want to mention all the names because I might forget it, but really, and also Julia, who put me up today from the airport, you know, I thank you all. Now, before I do, you see, I like to read just from the verse from the Quran, usually, about peace. Now, let me tell you something. We say that, and also the Talmud has it, it says that we ordained for the children of Israel that whoever kills a human being for other than manslaughter, a corruption in the earth, it shall be as if he has killed all mankind. And whosoever saves a life, it shall be as if he has saved the life of all mankind. I could do it in Arabic, but because of the time in here, you get my point. So to me here, I tell you frankly, I was born in Jerusalem, the Israel. We had peace with our Jewish community, settlement. And then before the partition took place, like Gibeat Shaul, Mount Fiori, Mahan Yehuda, our village was surrounded by three sides Jewish settlements. And the only side is the west side, which anybody can escape if somebody attacked you. And that's exactly what we used, the west side to escape. Now, what happened in here to me at that time, just very briefly, is that on the 9th, I can tell you what happened the day. I was doing the day before the massacre, the day on the massacre, and after the massacre. The day before the massacre, here my grandmother was 96 years of age, my brother Omar was 2 years of age, and my sister Nazira was 6 years of age, my grandmother 96, my brother Omar 2, my sister and myself, 4 of us. And what happened, I hear we sat down before, we sitting down in the balcony and the veranda and eating, you know, zaytun and za'atar and hummus and the nice figs and oranges, grapes and so forth. And we're talking, the day before. I never expected that day would be the last day of my grandmother and my brother Omar. Was 2 years of age, they were killed by the gangs, what we call the Irgun Israeli army, and Shtern and the Haganah later on, who came down. I never expected that. They were shot. My sister was taken captive, and my mother was taken captive. The long story is in my book, you can read it. I don't want to go too much detail on it, but 29 of my own families, uncles, aunts, so forth, they were killed. By the way, every time you read the Deir Yassin massacre, in all the books, it says 254 people were killed. Now I vow and I made a promise, I would never speak except the truth, nothing but the truth. And I speak to truth, and then this is going to cause a problem in my community when I tell them that the only people, the number of people who were killed, and I have their names in here. Nobody can argue with me because I was there. 93 people they were killed. 90 from the village and 3 from outside. Who are the 3 from the outside? The teacher who was in school, teacher. She was wounded. She was actually helping the wounded people, and then a lady came and shot her. And the other 2 was from Hebron, Khalil. And this lady, by the way, from Jerusalem. She used to come every day and go back to Jerusalem. Her name is Hayat al-Balbisi. Now the other 2 were a baker man and his son, were from Hebron. We have only 1 oven, and we have only 1 telephone, we have only 3 TVs by batteries, and we have no electricity, 700 people, the whole village, and so forth. So this baker, according to one of the witnesses who are in California, and I put in my book, he said that they came, one of the arguments that they owe me, they came to the bakery man and told the bakery man, please put your son in the oven. Put him, throw him in there. So the son was trembling and he was holding his father's clothes. Please, daddy, don't do it, please. And he was scared. My father, do you think I will do it? I will go before you do. Anyhow, he says, this is the case. He threw them both in the oven and they were baked. He says, go meet yourselves, you and your son, in paradise and so forth. So they were killed. As a result in here, the 254 came because there is a Red Cross man, his name Rene, Frenchman. He wanted to go to Jerusalem to see what happened. The Zionist prevented him from going there. He did not go there the first day, the second day, but he went the third day. He could not see anyone. They threw all the bodies of the people in dry well. But one from Gibat Shaul, who are our neighbors and whom we always have, you see, we're not against the Jews. We are against the Zionists, because the Jewish people that, you know, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, three monotheistic religion, everybody respect. But the Zionism is different. It's a political party which came and dismissed the original inhabitants of Palestine. So one of the Gibat Shaul, he pointed to the well, the third man, and on the third day, he pointed, thank you. He pointed to the French man about the well. So the man, the Red Cross man, René, he opened the well and he estimated 254, I don't know how. But right away the Jewish press there, they said 254. The Arab also media more than that, you know, 254, exaggerated the whole thing. And then the New York Times right away became 254 and became like a blogger, like everybody 254. But I myself in here, I cannot do that. I have to speak the truth because sooner or later the truth will come and my book will not be good. Okay? So, we lived, I said, with the Jewish people. We lived together. We went to the same school. We sat in the same tables. We ate in the same places. They used to come, the Jewish people, they come to our village and eat fruits and stay with us. We go, they used to give us matzah and so forth. And nothing between us. In fact, there was a lady here called Benina, a Jewish lady. And I remember, you know, she had a boyfriend, and her boyfriend was a pilot. And he was shot. He's from Ashkenaz, she's a daughter from an Ashkenaz man. Her father brought her to our house. We gave her a room for 2 years. In fact, you know, in our village, you know, we use the toilets, you know, the old-fashioned one. You don't have even a seat there. But for her, we made special one for her to accommodate her. In fact, her father brought for her a husband, maybe she will, she'll be okay, but she, it didn't work out. But what I'm telling you here is that we have no difference, we have a peace agreement with the, with our Jewish neighbors not to attack. And even from Gibeah Sha'ul, you know, the people when they were fighting the Arab and Israeli home in the Shtern, he says, why are you doing people this? These people, they never killed one from us. Why are you attacking them? There are good neighbors in here, and so forth. In fact, they told them, you are bastards. He's one of the neighbors. What I'm telling you, it was peaceful. But after the partition, the thing became worse. Now, the night before, here we saw, in Gibeah Sha'ul, we saw lights and we saw armored trucks. We know that something is wrong. So what happened in here? Some, we had, we made some points to protect our village. And our house was the first one from the east side. See, our house was exactly half the distance between Gibeah Sha'ul, the first settlement, and the downtown area, the first one. And we were 12 of us, my uncles mostly. Now, my turn was at that night to serve from 6 o'clock to 12 o'clock at night, and the others from 12 to 6. Now, I had served from 6 to 12, and I went to sleep with my grandmother in one room, and my sister and my brother in one room. So what happened in here, okay, I have 5 minutes now. What happened, I have to finish very fast. What happened in here, at 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning, my grandmother, she came and she woke me up. She says, what happened? She told me, Arabic, you know, go upstairs and see that your fathers, your aunties are shooting. Of course, you know, just being 17 years, you know, I didn't listen to her for a while. Then after 15 minutes, she came and yanked me up from the bed and told me, see what happened. And here I looked at the window to the village. You should see everything ablaze. The whole village was ablaze. And all you could see is hand grenades and tuk 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 boom and all that stuff. And right away I got upstairs in here and then we prevented. There was an armored truck came from the Gibeah Sha'ul. But we have quarries in our village, we have quarries, two big quarries. We made a ditch in between. And when the armored trucks came in here, we prevented her from coming to the village. Otherwise, maybe half or maybe two-thirds of the village would have massacred. If it wasn't for us, we prevented for about 3 hours. Anyhow, myself in here, by miracle in here, I went and put myself in a trench. This trench was during the Ottoman Empire, the Turks. And it's the only way which go to the West Point. I crept in my belly. That time I have a lot of hair, and every time the trench becomes shallow, I go up like this. My hair comes up, and then all I see the bullets, you know, over my head, and my hair goes up and so forth. I go down. Anyhow, we managed to go to the west side. And now the captives, what they did with the captives. Now here's a story about my mother, which I never forget, and it's a sad story. Now, my mother at that time was not with us. She was in the downtown area. She was pregnant for eight months, and she wanted to go to her, my aunt, to see if something happened to help her out. But what happened in here, now my grandmother, one of my uncles was behind me when we withdrew. He was afraid and he could not run. So he stayed in the house. So I called to my sister, who is 6 years of age now, and she's in New Jersey, and I told Sarah, maybe if you have a chance to bring and let her tell you the story, how it happened. When the Zionists came inside the house and found my uncle, they shot him, and my sister said that he went down to the floor, and he was going around here about 6 times, you know, and then they told my grandmother and my brother to stay there. They will pick him up coming back as captives. But what happened, my brother Omar, he was hungry, and then my grandmother took him downtown to see my mother and so forth. But what happened in here, during their walk, a lady came and shot my grandmother with my brother Omar on her shoulder. He went down. And then my sister slept with him, thinking that she was dead. After 2-3 hours, they came and they took her. She moved and took her to the house where the captives lived. Over there, she saw my mother. And when my mother told her, said, Nazeeha, What happened to your brother Daoud? For me, he said, I don't know what happened to him. What happened to your uncle Rabwan? He said they shot him in the house. What happened to your grandma, your grandmother and your brother Omar? He says, well, he was shot also. If you want, I'll show you where it is. So she asked the guard of the where the captives are to go and see my brother, as my mother. So my mother, he was good, he was nice, you know. Some people are nice there because the Haganah came later on and they start to take, they say this is an army, trained army, and they start to take captives and start killing. So he took her. Now my mother, look at the scenery. My mother took my brother, Omar, her son, in her hand. No blood. I mean, there is blood, but no bullets. He probably, when he fell down, he probably went to his head, concussion or coma, but he's not moving. My mother wanted to take him with her. He told her, no, I have orders. Either you put it or I shoot you. And from that moment, my mother, from that moment, 1948, till she passed away, that agony in her, saying to herself, why didn't I take my son and let that man shoot me? And she died with all this, with all that sadness in her heart. Now, what happened? The last thing in here, What happened in here? Those people, the one who took them captives, they put them in the trucks. First, they let put them in the trucks, and they took them to Mahne Yehuda. They paraded them with victory, and so forth. They took all their clothes. They took all the jewelry from them. And they gave him to put him in a hotel in Jerusalem. Now, the scenery there, which I never forgive myself in here, imagine like my father, luckily he was at that time with my brother, six brothers, seven brothers, were in Majdar, in Gaza. He was actually finishing a contract for the British Army before they leave in 15 May 1948. He wasn't there, thanks God. But when he came from, when he had the massacre, and he came to that house, I just want you to imagine, you know, they put all those survivors in a small hotel in Jerusalem. And those people who have families who were outside the village, they came and look at those people here. If they are there, they are alive. If they are not there, remember there. And you see the commotion in here. They tell me, where is Jamila? Where is Amina? Where is this? Where is this? Somebody says, well, these were killed. We don't know what happened to this and so forth. The commotion took place in here is unbelievable to see. Now, as you know here, We have nothing against the Zionists. The only thing we know, I have a lot of friends in Jerusalem. By the way, in the last 3 years, 3.5 years now, I went to Jerusalem 7 times and to South Korea 2 times. But it hurts to see me when I visited that Holocaust. I went down there for almost, boy, it's a big one here. You could maybe take 2-3 days to see it. Now here I'm seeing that thing, and they're looking at my Deir Yassin village, which is about only maybe 1.5 kilometers away from the mountain, and I cannot go there. How come, what crime did they make in here to have a Soviet Jew in my house, in Deir Yassin? He made my house halfway carpentry and the other half he lives with it. And how come I cannot go there and he's there? See, that's the problem here. This is not justice. And the Middle East, it is, I'm sorry to say that USA is not a just broker. And if you want to solve the Middle East problem, you need a just broker. You need somebody who can deliver from both sides. I like Sharon, I don't like Sharon, but I respect him in one thing, he can deliver. He went from Gaza and so forth. But in both sides, they don't have a good man who deliver. But still, I am a religious man, and I always hope and optimistic that someday, which God willing, will come and live together.
So it's my honor to introduce Daoud Assad. Daoud is a survivor of the Deir Yassin massacre. For people who are unfamiliar with that massacre, it occurred on April 9th, 1948, and it was part of the terror campaign that Zionist militia, the Sturm Gang, the Irgun, Jewish Zionist militia used to terrorized Palestinians and send a message that if they did not voluntarily leave Palestine, that similar massacres would follow. And so...
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Paul. Now, before I go here, see, I like to read just from the view, a verse from the Quran, usually, about peace. Now, let me tell you something. We say that, and also the Talmud has it, it says that we ordained for the children of Israel that whoever kills a human being for other than manslaughter, a corruption in the earth, it shall be as if he has killed all mankind. And whosoever saves a life, it shall be as if he has saved the life of all mankind. I could do it in Arabic, but because of the time in here, you get my mic. Okay, I'm going to say now, because the 15 minutes that are allowed to ask, you know, how could you explain about the whole massacre which took place, how to explain about the Palestine problem, but I'd like to be short. But before I do that, you know, I want to greet you by the three greetings. Say shalom, salam, peace be upon you all. And you are such a good, wonderful audience, and I want to thank the people who are working on, who had worked on this project, you know, to bring it to reality and success, Sue and Sarah and others in here. I don't want to mention all the names because I might forget it, but really, and also Julia, who put me up today from the airport, you know.
Daoud is an author and has written a book that accounts not only his history, but the history of other survivors of Deir Yassin. He's going to share with us a very powerful story of his experience, both surviving that, but also being part of trying to resist it. And Daoud has also brought those books here, and if you're interested, at the end, you can come up and buy a book and have him sign it. So please join me in welcoming Daoud.
So to me here, I'll tell you frankly, I was born in Jerusalem, the Israel. We had peace with our Jewish community, settlement. And that before the partition took place, like Gibeat Shaul, Mount Fiori, Mahan Yehuda, our village was surrounded by three sides Jewish settlements. And the only side is the west side, which anybody can escape if somebody attacked you. And that's exactly what we used, the west side to escape. Now, what happened in here to me at that time, just briefly, is that on the 9th,